Would you like to come out today? Oh, yes, please, said Edward. So they lit his fire, made lots of steam, and Edward puffed away.
Cab Your Fears, an audio story by EdwardsDayOut. One winter's evening, James puffed into the shed at the big station. He had been on passenger trains this week and was very pleased with himself. Early, 2 days in a row. Though, he didn't find it a bit suspicious that the fat controller put him on passenger trains somewhat randomly. No matter, he thought. He's just realizing how splendid I really am. The other engines greeted him. Evening, James, said Edward. Good evening, everyone, he said. Another lovely day today. You've been having a lot of those recently, said Henry. Well, when you're as splendid as I am. Most days are good days, James boasted. Here we go again, said Percy. Do you even know how to use the word splendid, little James? Gordon snorted. What, have you been taking grammar classes now? James scoffed. You have no room to talk about... Good evening, engines, a voice coughed. The engine's eyes darted to the fat director, who was standing with a somewhat cheeky smile.
Evening, sir,
they said in unison.
I have some special duties to give out tonight. The Pure Godred Aluminum Company has just taken on a large order that is due to be shipped out in a month. I need an engine to assist with completing the shipment. He looked at James, who suddenly realized why he'd been put on passenger duties. James, I believe...
What?
James shrieked. The other engines laughed.
I believe,
the fat director said crossly,
you would be the perfect engine for the job.
But sir, James pleaded, I'm a mainline engine. Branch lines don't suit me.
I thought you would be more appreciative after I gave you the local for the week,
the fat director said sternly.
With that attitude, I think it's time that you expanded your horizons.
James could only scowl as the fat director explained to Henry that he would need to take the extra trucks from Kildane. He fell crossly to sleep. Next morning, his driver woke him early to make the journey up to the fortified town. Come on, James, we've got a bit of a trip.
5 more minutes, James yawned.
No, we're already 10 minutes late. The sun was just beginning to rise as James made his way to the island's industrial heartland. Pale Godred, Kildane, and to some extent Kronk, were where over half of the island's processed goods came from. It is also where the island's most beautiful sights could be seen. It was then somewhat of a shame that the branch line was treated just as an extension of the main line. Little to no passenger services ran, especially as the Coldy Fell had closed for the winter, and apparently the aluminum company loaned one of its engines to ferry goods down from the town. James had never met the fellow, but her work ethic seemed good if she was only needing help just now. As he passed over the Kronk Viaduct, he spotted a large purple shape in the yard. As he got closer, he realized it was an engine. Her purple paint with bright stripes was faded, but she seemed to be in good condition. She smiled as James approached.
Hello there, you must be James. I've come to show you the line. Oh, where are my manners? I'm Olivia. I work at the bauxite mine a bit further up the branch.
Nice to meet you, Olivia.
James tried to force a smile. Olivia didn't seem to take much notice.
Our truck's over there. We mustn't be late. The manager would not like that very much. No, sir.
She motioned to a long line of empty trucks with brake vans at both ends. The trucks were very dirty, and James shivered as he looked at them.
Shall I go in front, or you?
I'll go in front,
James said, still looking at the trucks. One of them made a face at him as Olivia puffed gently to the front.
Worse and worse, James sighed.
The two engines left Kronk and made their way up the line. Despite the terrain he was pulling, James couldn't help but gawk at the view in front of him. Ahead lay dozens of massive mountains, the morning sun making shadows in the valley below. The railway clung to the side of the peaks, the embankment being just a few feet taller than the river beside it. Trees dotted the hillsides and became more common further up the valley. James had to admit, it was a beautiful line. He only wished he was pulling passages through it.
It really is pretty, isn't it?
Olivia said.
Yes, I suppose it is,
James said. He suddenly noticed a tree quite close to the line side. It swayed in the wind and looked like it had died a long time ago. James gritted his teeth as the sharp branches seemed to reach for his lovely red coat.
Why haven't the gangers got that bloody tree yet? It almost scratched my splendid paint.
Oh, that old thing. It's not too close to the line. There'll be much more important work to worry about, if I do say so myself. Fits the scenery anyway, I think.
James couldn't agree less. They passed a mountain railway, under a bridge, through a large forest, and finally to a massive stone wall. Roofs peeked over it, and it was dotted with tall towers along its edges. It was quite a sight to behold, but it was soon gone as the engines entered a dark tunnel. James expected the station to be just as magnificent, but when they exited, they came to a small, shabby station platform. The small wooden building was rotten, the glass in the short canopy was cracked, and on the booking office sat a sign that read, "Out to Lunch." By the age of the sign, James reckoned lunch was over several years ago.
What do you think?
It's quaint.
James tried to be polite but was having trouble, as his eyes stared at the state of the carriage shed. The station yard looked like it hadn't been used in decades.
Manager said that we'll leave your trucks here, and you can take them down to Kildane. Apparently your wheelbase is too long for the corners or something. I don't really know. I'll go get your trucks.
She was decoupled and scampered off around the corner. James's driver looked around. Best get you turned round for the trip back. If only I could see the table. He squinted. James looked around the desolate yard.
Surely they must at least have a turntable, he thought.
Gordon's incident with pulling the express backwards bounced in his smoke box. He wouldn't want to play tank engine as well. In the corner, near the carriage shed, was a small wooden turntable.
Over there,
said James. He puffed over, but as they got closer, his crew realized something.
James, I don't think you're gonna fit.
Nah, we'll be fine,
James insisted.
James, we'll be fine,
said James. Too tired to argue, his crew agreed. James rolled onto the creaking turntable. It groaned under his weight. His crew leapt down when suddenly,
eek!
James screamed as he trapped his game. With a slam, James was front first in the wall.
Oh, botheration,
said James as the dust settled. His crew sighed and went to phone for help. It took the rest of the day and night to get James out of the well.
Okay, let's see what
the Peel Godred had no crane strong enough to lift an engine, and it took several hours to find one small enough to fit inside the tunnel. By the time James was raised out, it was very late. He was pushed to the carriage shed and went crossly to sleep. When he was woken, it was yet again early morning. He yawned as his fireman made steam. We've got to go backwards to Peel Godred today, said his driver.
But I thought the Fat Director didn't want us tender engines traveling backwards, said James.
We'll go slowly. It's not like we got much of a choice. James backed his way out of the station and through the tunnel. When he emerged, his driver saw a thick fog and blanketed the valley.
Good grief, he said to the fireman. I can hardly see a thing for this pea soup.
Wait till we get to the valley, she said.
James began to pick up speed as he ascended.
Steady on, James,
his driver called.
The rails are slippery. What do you want me to do about it?
He said grumpily. The driver applied the brakes, but they continued to pick up speed. He turned on the sanding gear, which worked, but very slowly. James didn't seem to be putting much effort into stopping.
Come on, James, we don't want to end up in the wall. Oh, Lord, duck! What?
James felt something scrape against his side.
Hey, ouch!
He yelled. Now his brake screeched into a stop.
What happened?
He said. The fireman stood in shock as his shovel, so pointed up, finally stopped ringing. A large branch was on the floor of the cab.
Bloody hell, that could have nearly taken me head off,
she shouted.
Do you see why we need to go slowly now, James?
He said as he noticed a familiar tree next to the line.
Well, sorry I'm used to mainline sprints, not these branch line jogs.
His driver sighed. Well, I suppose we could use some more protection, since we'll be running backwards for the foreseeable future. I wonder. James was confused, but decided not to think much of his driver's comment as they backed much more slowly down the line. The fat director had been informed of James's incident and had a stern word with the gangers on the Peel Godred branch about gross neglect of loading gauges. He also sent James to the works for slight repairs and, to James's delight, a repaint. Little did James know he requested something else as well. When James awoke a few days later, he found that his driver and fireman were staring at something behind him.
What a fine job they've done. Yes, indeed. Looks like it's always been there.
What are you two talking about?
James said sleepily as he opened the smoke box door. His jaw dropped.
What?
He shouted as he saw the modifications the workmen had made to his tender. It now had a tender cab, with roof and reinforced backplate. It was the same color scheme as the rest of James, and looked like it was almost meant to be there. Still, James was indignant.
Get that thing off my tender!
What, do you not like your new tender cab?
Oh, I look like a tank engine! Get it off! Get it off!
Stow it, James, his fireman said.
It's for our safety. It's already been bolted down anyway. Let's get a move on.
James had no choice but to comply. He grumbled all the way to Peel Godred, and was still grumbling when he brought his trucks back down to Kildane. Henry was there waiting.
Well, 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 what do we have here? A new engine? I've never seen a tank engine like that before. He chuckled.
Shut up, Henry, it's not funny, James shouted.
Oh, I beg to differ. Wait till Gordon hears, he laughed as he jumped away to add the trucks to his train.
That Henry, I swear, James said crossly. He's so big for his wheels, he is.
Reminds me of someone,
his fireman laughed. James glared at her. James half expected the same reaction from Olivia, but when he met her at the Mountain Railway Station, she seemed impressed.
That's a very clever thing you've got on your tender. I've never seen anything like it. You look very stylish.
No, it's big, hard, and awkward.
Whatever do you mean? It looks very useful. Very important to protect our crew. The fog is often as thick as smoke in the mornings and they have trouble seeing. I should know. I want...
Oh, whatever.
James let off steam and puffed away in a huff. Olivia looked confused as the train left.
Was it something I said? Oh, hello.
She smiled as a blue and black butterfly landed on her nose. James was still grumbling when it began to rain as he approached the goods yard. The clouds overhead were black and foreboding. He was coupled up to his full wagons and waited for the guard's whistle.
Frank's late again with the getting his lunch, it seems, said the driver. Hope he brought an umbrella. Rain's really starting to pick up, said the fireman.
And it was. By the time they left the top station, thunder roared from above. James wished he was back at his warm berth at Knapford. His crew were thankful for the new roof over their heads. James jumped as lightning cracked on the mountaintop.
Easy, James. It's only a storm.
Only a storm is an understatement,
James shouted over the wind. His driver peered through the porthole.
Brake signal ahead.
He put on the brakes. But James didn't stop.
Not this again, James. Come on, focus.
I am,
he yelled. His brakes screamed as he dove past the tree. The heavy trucks of metal pushed him past the city. James blew a panicked whistle for the guard to put on the brakes.
Not again.
His wheels spun and spun. He rocketed down the twists and turns to the line.
Put him in forward,
yelled the fireman. The shovel was a blur as the driver tried to regain control. Suddenly, something hit James's tender cab. There was quite the jolt, but the driver and fireman were unhurt. James's tender felt much heavier as he came to a stop.
What was that?
Said James. The driver looked back. Sitting atop the tender was an old gray and brown tree.
Well, would you look at that? He laughed. James has got a tree!
James was beside himself as the crew had a good chuckle. They saw an amber lamp, and a signalman walked up.
Why didn't you stop when I sent the signal? He said. That tree across the line could have given you a nasty accident.
Yes, but it didn't, thanks to that cab they fitted. Came in very useful, didn't it, James? I suppose it did, said James, who was starting to reconsider his thoughts on what was bolted to his tender. The tree was soon removed from James's tender, and he had no more accidents on the way home. Everyone soon knew what had happened, and the Fat Director made sure that a length limit on the aluminum trains was implemented when it was raining.
We certainly don't want this incident to cause our contracts to be axed, he smiled.
James snickered. There were no more mishaps on the Pilgaudry for the rest of the month, and Henry apologized to James for his comment.
I suppose that thing does help in a jam, he said.
James couldn't agree more.
It really is quite useful, and makes me look much more splendid, he smiled.
Henry and James's crew just laughed.